thanks for the invitation. I am in esteemed company, if not a little out of my depth. I'm very conscious that I'm amongst scientists and I am a simple farmer. Well, and my degree from Essex University is an honorary one. It's not proper ones like you probably have, so it's an honorary doctorate. So very proud of it, and I'm very proud of my roots. As Ian said, my role is as Vice President of the NFU. For those who don't know the National Farmers Union, we represent 50,000 farmers in England and Wales. We do not get into Scotland or Northern Ireland. And we reckon, although this is sometimes contested, that we represent 70% of commercial agriculture, although how you define a farmer is an endless debate. And I'm very conscious that we're next door to the OPPO here, as we call the CLA. But they are, the L is for landowners, the F is for farming. And that is a difference, although quite clearly there is a fair amount of crossover. Before I get into the meat of this issue, and I'm very keen that we get into questions as soon as possible, because I suspect I have as much to learn from you as you have to learn from me. But I thought I'd just introduce myself by placing myself geographically and tell you something about my farm and tell you something about what farmers love to talk about the most, and that is our weather. So I hail from the northeast Essex coast, from a village called St. Osyth, which is famous for its priory. If you ever get a chance to visit, it's well worth visiting. And we are just down the coast from a place called Clacton-on-Sea, which is now notorious as being known as UKIP Central. We have another unique property in as much that we are the only constituency to return a UKIP MP, Mr. Douglas Carswell. And in the run-up to a certain referendum we may be facing, as the NFU, we are involved in that debate. It's an interesting place to farm at this moment in time. But I have one spurious claim to fame in the village of St. Osyth, and that is I farm the driest spot in the British Isles. This always excites an enormous amount of controversy, especially when I'm speaking in farming circles, and it basically engenders hate mail, where people write to me and say, how dare you suggest you are the driest farm in Britain, old boy. I think of it as actually me, and you are nothing but a charlatan, a fraud, and a liar. There's a quick response to that. It's page 22 of the Guinness Book of Records. I'm in it, they're not. End of issue. Okay? But just to sort of just try and prove to you, and I will get onto the issue, I promise you, very shortly, to prove to you how dry my climate is, and it is related to this issue of neonicotinoids. We have occasionally dipped down to levels of rainfall, which technically defines us as a desert. So normally, we would get an average rainfall of about 20 inches a year. Very few spots in Britain actually get below the 500 millimetre annual rainfall record. And they're to be found on the noses of the Essex estuaries. And for you scientists, you meteorologists amongst you, you'll know that as rain-bearing clouds move west to east, obviously they spill themselves on high ground. And so the east gets generally less than the west. And by the time it gets to us, the negative ions in rain clouds are attracted to the positive ions in the sea. And so they rush, the rain clouds rush up the estuary do not come to that little nose, which is the south end of the Tendry Peninsula where I farm. And so that's the story of why I am dry as I am. And as said, we have occasionally dipped below 12 inches of rain, which has technically meant we are a desert. But obviously, as you know, deserts are hot places with a lot of transpiration, but our rainfall can get that sparse. And at times that is a blessing when you are harvesting crops which need to be brought in dry. It is the best place to farm when you are in short of spring or autumn rainfall. It can be not a blessing. It is at other times of the year. And I have had some doubtful notoriety because of this claim I have that I am the man that farms the Essex Desert. And I've had some semi-serious articles written about me in the farming press and even in the national press. The Times have come and done a feature on me as well. And then the inevitable happened one April morning. It was a Sunday morning. I remember it well. phone went, it was early on, and I was a bit groggy-headed because I played hockey the day before and spent the rest of the evening in the bar. And the voice on the other end of the phone said, "Hello, Mr. Smith, we're from the Sun newspaper. We like this story about you being the man that farms the Essexes. Could we come and do a feature on your farm?" And without thinking, I said, "Yeah, I'm okay with that." And they said, "Very good, we'll be in your yard in 2 hours' time." And the phone went down. And I turned to my wife and said, "Darling, the Sun newspaper are coming to the farm. Isn't that marvellous? They wanted a feature about farming." And she furrowed her brow and said, "I don't think the Sun newspaper are going to be interested in farming, are they?" And she was damn right. They they turned out with Big Chief Black Hawk. And although you despair of the Sun newspaper and their rather cavalier attitude to journalism, he was a genuine North American Indian rain dancer from North Carolina. Hit tarmac at Heathrow at 9 o'clock, on my farm by 11, praying for rain. His actual name was Dennis, which I thought was very curious. But aside from that, as you can imagine, a genuine North American Indian rain dancer in Essex, very charismatic man. I remember him for three things. One is, he said to me, "Guy, the beauty of being a rain dancer is you can always guarantee it will rain after you've done the dance. What you can't guarantee is how soon it will rain after you've done the dance." I was worried for him that rain dancing may be a serious sort of quasi-religious thing handed down from many forebears. And I didn't want him to think he wasn't being treated with due respect. And out of the earshot of the Sun journalists who were with him at the time, I said to him, "You do realise that the Sun newspaper is basically a comic. It won't take this very seriously." And he got the gist of what I was saying to me. He says, "Guy, for £8,000, I'll do what the hell they want me to do." And finally, he put his big bronze hands on my wife's tummy, because my wife, Julia, was heavily pregnant at the time, 8.5 months pregnant. And he looked her in the eye and he said, "Julia, that's a little boy. He will grow to be a fine young man. He will be a son you are truly proud of." And sure enough, 2 weeks later, my youngest daughter was born. So, and it just goes to show that if you're in the business of predicting the future and you've got a 50-50 chance, have a go. Just make sure you're not there when the result comes out to prove you wrong. And as you can imagine, I am the talk of the village since this event sort of 10 years ago, as you could tell by the lack of grey hair at the time. People say to me, "After the chief appeared on the farm, did you notice a change in the pattern of precipitation on your farm?" And I always think, well, yeah, we have noticed it get wetter and drier. And just quickly, climate change, as you can imagine, is a big issue for farmers, because if our climate is becoming more volatile, if we are swinging from drought to flood, and the weather bombs that have hit farmers in the north of England are a testimony for that, and the desert status I've achieved three or four times in the last 20 years are a testimony to that, food production is becoming more challenging, because not only is volatile weather difficult for a farmer to handle, it also makes his markets more volatile, because world markets in world-traded commodities such as wheat and barley and milk, they tend to go from surfeit to surplus very quickly, and that makes prices very erratic and volatile. So going forward, the farmer has the twin challenge of farming in a volatile weather and in volatile markets. And this volatility is going to characterise farming into the future, and it's those farmers that can manage this volatility best will best survive. So let's get on to the nub, finally, of this evening, and that is why farmers use insecticides, particularly neonicotinoids, when it comes to the cultivation of their crops. So that is a very young oilseed rape plant. Oilseed rape has a very small seed. It's like a little shot, very small ball. And so of all the seeds that I tend to grow, it tends to be the smallest. You sow it for its autumn cultivar in late August and early September. It is difficult to establish because of its small nature. It's difficult to get good soil to seed contact. So you can make sure that the seed chits when you get rain. It's also difficult to cultivate and establish because in August, September, the climate is still dry. Your soils are still dry. And so it's problematic to establish. And in difficult establishment years, when seed beds are what farmers call cloddy, so they're made up of marbles or something larger rather than a nice beach-like seed bed, it's difficult to get your seeds to grow and grow away quickly. And in those years, it's very prone to damage from pests. Two in particular. One is the slug, which we use a chemical called metaldehyde to control the slug. And the other is cabbage stem flea beetle. And neonicotinoid seed dressings give us protection from damage from cabbage stem flea beetle. That's why we use it. Now, the difficulty is, and it's difficult for sometimes non-farming audience to understand, that farmers use neonicotinoid seed treatments as an insurance. They work on the basis that it probably will be a difficult year to establish rape. There will be a high level of insect pressure, and so they use it as insurance. And that has caused controversy, particularly in the last 2 years, because we've used them in limited situations with a derogation from the European Union. But I'll confess, we haven't necessarily needed them because we haven't had difficult years. But that does not mean to say that the farmer is using neonicotinoids in some sort of broad spectrum, don't really care if they're needed or not, belt and braces way. He's doing it for good reasons because his experience suggests that in 1 in 3 years he will lose his crop if he doesn't protect it from flea beetle. And as you can see, the flea beetle is a ravaging pest. It has this typical shot holing of the leaves, and if it gets too much, the plant cannot grow away. It either dies or becomes stunted and never turns into a productive plant. Having said that, rape is one of those, also grape is one of those crops that has great compensating powers, especially in its later flowering stages. So it's difficult for the farmer to evaluate insect pressure and to turn it into yield. Neonicotinoids are reasonably cheap. They've been widely used since the early 90s. They are becoming the standard way to control cabbage stem flea beetle, but they have been banned in the last 2 years, and farmers were not allowed to use them in the autumn of 2014 and suffered considerable damage, particularly in hot spots along the M11 corridor. Last year, the NFU achieved a derogation application. So when the European Union regulatory powers ban a substance from use on farm in a specific instance, so it was they banned the three neonicotinoid chemicals we can use for obviously rape. The United Kingdom government is completely within its right and power to ignore that if they feel that there is an emergency need for the use of that chemical. And they do it quite routinely. All European Union countries will do this. Where they feel that there is good reason to ignore the ban or the moratorium, they will do this. Common practice. So last year, the NFU, unusually for the NFU, applied for a derogation to use neonicotinoids. Our first derogation was to use it on 50% of the national UK crop. That was rejected as not being limited and targeted enough. And we were told that we would have to, if we put in a more limited application, it might be successful. So we applied for 5% in those counties that the AHDB, well, the technical living body that look at these sorts of issues, decided that the damage was most pronounced in Suffolk, Bedfordshire, Cambridgeshire and Hertfordshire. And so a third of the rape in those counties were grown with neonicotinoid seed dressing, and the remainder, 95% of the UK crop, was not. If a farmer, even if he has neonicotinoids, if once the plant is growing, he will assess the pressure, because neonicotinoids are not the 100% solution to flea beetle damage. The flea beetle will continue to be active, and he may subsequently use more insecticides, the pyrethroids insecticides at a later date. One of the arguments against neonicotinoids is because of their possibility of having a negative impact on bees, farmers have alternatives that they could use. That's not strictly true, it's roughly true. But the thing with those family of chemicals to use at the post-emergence state of the plant, sorry, I'm struggling, the pyrethroids, is that we are seeing increasing amounts of pyrethroid resistance amongst cabbage stem flea beetle. And so the more we use pyrethroid, the more we are eating up its longevity, because the more we spray it, the more resistance there is, and the more useless it becomes. So as farmers, we are very keen to use a combination of insecticides to give us the necessary balance to control cabbage stem flea beetle. So, sorry, I'm running on. In addition to cabbage stem flea beetle eating the young emerging cotyledon, it will also lay its eggs in the stem of the plant and produce a maggot. I'm sure there's a scientific word for that, you can tell me, but as a farmer, I know it as a maggot. And this will transmit further viruses that can damage the crop. And that's the secondary reason why we need to control the flea beetle and keeping it away from the emerging crop. And farmers may also spray, and this is obviously a flowering grape crop. So in terms of the calendar, we sowed the seed in autumn and September. I'm sorry, I thought I was giving lectures to primary school children. I thought I'd revert back to explaining it to them. But we sow the seed in August and September, just when you're going back to school, I normally say. the plant emerges, and then in the spring it grows rapidly and turns into quite a large plant. And then late April and early May it starts to flower. And I suppose this is where it gets controversial, because this is when it starts producing pollen and it starts attracting a lot of bee activity. Farmers may have to spray when it's flowering for additional insect pests. And when we do that, we like to think we use selective insecticides that do not impact on bee health. But look, let's be candid here. Insecticides are not good for insects. There's a clue in the title, okay? And so I'll readily admit that when a farmer seeks to control or protect his crop from insect damage, he is compromising the insect ecology of his farm. I would not expect you to be naive enough to say to you there is no implication for insects or bees or benign insects from using insecticides. There is a balance. There is a price to pay. But when we get to this stage of crop, I personally, if I had a flowering crop of rape, I would only spray it late in the evening when the bees had returned to the hive. And I think that's generally accepted as standard practice. Now, farmers are very reluctant to spray flowering crops of rape, but in 1 year in five, we may spray them for insect damage. It's not common. And we would also spray fungicides to control diseases in the crop, maybe once or twice in the spring. And the thing about rape is that I have beehives on my farm. Beekeepers use my farm, and I'm very pleased to see them. And I like the odd pot of honey, and that's the deal. I don't charge them. And there is a sort of suggestion that farmers need bees to pollinate crops. And for people running orchards and maybe things like field beans, that is important. Rape will usually be pollinated by whatever insects or by the wind. It's quite a free pollinating crop. But it does attract a lot of insects. And the reason bees like it is because it is a very early source of pollen. It's producing pollen and nectar in late April, early May. And beekeepers like it because they tell me it gives the bees their first fix. They don't always tell me it makes the best honey. It can be quite crystalline. But they like it because it gets their bees out and about and gets them going for the rest of the season. So that's the sort of the coexistence between the beekeeper and the farmer. We're very, at the moment, the NFU is trying to develop a new new notification strategy where through social media or the internet, farmers can alert beekeepers that they intend to spray their crops and what they intend to spray them with. Now, I will do this on a phone call basis to my beekeeper. My beekeeper is very relaxed about what I spray. He doesn't seem to think it's an issue. I know other beekeepers, and there may be some in the audience, are not so relaxed. And farmers respect that. And it's important that we work with the beekeeping community to minimise exposure to bees from chemicals that we spray. And one way to do that is by alerting local beekeepers when we're spraying, so they can keep the bees in the hive, or by spraying late at night. Just one other quick point is that, as far as I know, there is no organic production of oilseed rape in the UK. It is very difficult to control, to grow rape without chemical control, particularly because of insect pressure. And so organic farmers do not bother with oilseed rape. It's not a crop that they grow. And I think I'm right in saying that. I've looked at some figures and I certainly can't see any. And organic vegetable oil tends to come from other sources, not from oilseed rape. So it is a crop that is dependent on an element of chemical control, particularly of insects. But I would never suggest that farmers cannot see beyond the chemical can when it comes to controlling pests, weeds and diseases. And that is a bit of a throwaway insult, I think, to farmers. All farmers, organic or otherwise, will use a variety of means, non-chemical means, to control pests, weeds and diseases, whether it's rotation, whether it's variety selection, so you pick varieties that have good natural fungicide resistance. For weed control, we will use fallow, which is not the most cost-effective way to control weeds, but it's effective, but it's costly because the farmer has to isolate part of his farm to produce nothing. And, you know, we will try and grow cultivars that don't succumb easily to insect pressure. And so there are various non-chemical things we will do to make sure our crops are clean of disease, free of pests and free of weeds, which is not only good for the quality of the produce you have on the farm, it's also good for your yield and it's good for your bank balance. At the end of the day, we are running businesses. We are not running nature reserves or zoos or anything of such indulgence, unless you are a member of the royal family, and then you can do what you like because you've got money from elsewhere. Sorry, that was a rather throwaway remark. So to show you a very vivid illustration of why we use neonicotinoids, this was a trial done at a Syngenta farm in Suffolk, and you can see at the top there, the Cruiser is the trade name for the neonicotinoid. There is good establishment in the middle where it's untreated, more or less nothing, and at the bottom of the screen where just the pyrethroid has been used, you've got some plants survived, but it's still not as good as the Cruiser. And that's what it looks like. And I'll admit this is an extreme example of a situation where there was extreme insect pressure, where the Cruiser was sort of shown off in its best light. That would not necessarily be the case every time, but that is, there's no jiggery-pokery there. That is just showing you what the impact of using an neonicotinoid can have and what the impact of flea beetle can be. And you can see, even in the Cruiser-treated area, the crops are still rather stunted, and they're not looking what a farmer would call happy. And there is the species that causes the angst. The bee has become a poster, bug, for a number of green NGOs. Friends of the Earth tell me that this bee issue is the best Christmas present they've had since BSE and GMOs. It has added 30% to their membership. And it does attract a lot of attention. And farmers are aware of the controversy around this and the importance of the bee. The attention 2 or 3 years ago was on honeybees. There was a notable sequence of hive collapses in honeybees from the early 90s through to the mid-2000s, and it was felt that insecticides may be part of that reason for the hive collapse, although the varroa mites and bad husbandry by amateur beekeepers was another possible explanation. The evidence now suggests, or the work that we've seen suggests, that the impact on honeybees from neonicotinoids is not particularly proven. But now the switch has been to wild bees, and one man in particular, Professor Dave Golson at Sussex University, has done a lot of work where he has artificially fed neonicotinoid-laced pollen to bumblebees and released them into the wild, and has shown through the antennae on their back that they do not fly the way they would if they weren't really just drunk on neonicotinoids. I sometimes wonder if the antennae on the back of the bee has something to do with that, but that's just a throwaway remark. And that's the glorious British countryside in mid-May. Some people were convinced that rape pollen gives nothing but asthma. I seem to think it's rather marvellous, and I think it's like growing cut flowers on an arable farm. And I love to walk in a good crop of flowering orosi rape. It's a joyous thing. It's very sweet smelling, and it is full of insects and small birds predating on it. And that is obviously rape honey, which, as I said, beekeepers tell me is an easy thing to come across if they keep their bees near rape, particularly in that early period. But as you can see, it's rather white and rather crystalline. It's not considered to be the best. I just want to quickly talk about environmental schemes. So we have a suite of what we call Agri-Environmental Schemes in the UK at the moment, whereby farmers are paid to treat part of their farms as conservation zones away from the production zone. So this is my own farm. This is the St. Osyth Marsh, which is mainly below sea level. It's protected by sea defences. It is flat and featureless. Always has been, that's the nature of it. Before 100 years ago, it would have mainly produced sheep, and you can see from the old sheep barn, that's an old vestige, a ruin of that time 100 years ago. It was ploughed up during the First and Second World Wars when food was a strategic need for this country. In 1917, Lloyd George was told by the Chief of the Admiralty that we had 5 weeks food supply left and we may have to surrender to the German Kaiser, and indeed that was why the German Kaiser built up a submarine fleet in the early 1900s, because he realised that Britain's vulnerability was not military, it was dependent, 80% dependent on its food needs from imports, and so that's how he felt he could beat Britain, not on the on the battlefield, but on the seas sinking our food supplies. We got very close to that scenario. So these marshes were ploughed up in the First World War, and then a similar scenario with food security, 80% dependent on food again in 1939, and again these marshes ploughed up. And they've more or less been in an arable management regime since then. But my policy is around the edge of the field, or what we call the margin. I don't farm. I either put in pollen-rich nectar mixes, or plants that are good for wild birds, produce seeds, or just provide habitat on the right-hand side for ground nesting birds. And you can see those rather curious dog kennels on posts, which I'm sure you realise aren't dog kennels on posts, rather cruel for my Labrador. They are barn owl boxes, and I have a great love of barn owls, and I'm very pleased to see that through management of my margins and making sure I have a good vole population, my barn owl population is increasing and has increased twofold, threefold in the last 15 years. And that is the outside of one of our other fields, and that's what it looks like in the winter. So you can see the winter wheat crop on the left-hand side, and then the natural regenerated grass, and then above the barley crop to the right, and the pollen-rich nips looking good there. I always tell farming audience a quick anecdote, and I'm not sure it will work with an on-farming audience, but my father passed away about 5 years ago, and one of the last things I managed to do with Dad was do what he liked to do best, and that was look around the farm. And I got him into the car, and we had a good look around. He was enjoying it. I know what I'll do with Dad. I'll take him to see my freshly enhanced margins, because I was really proud of it. It was full of bees and flowers and skylarks, and it was super. And Dad wound the window down, took one look at it, and said, I think someone's missed the outside of the field with the sprayer. This was his reaction. And I think it was a distillation of a generational shift, whereby my father was a post-war farmer. I have no criticism of that generation of farmers. They were told to produce more because of strategic need, and that's what they did. I think maybe they changed the landscape unnecessarily, and they moved before and didn't explain to the wider public what they were doing. I'm convinced my generation of farmers, the baby boomers, we have embraced the conservation agenda. 75% of farmers are in these schemes where we have these margins. This is quite a common sight now in Essex and wider East Anglia. And I'm convinced it delivers on biodiversity and the like. And so when the question was, you know, are farmers be aware? Yes, we are. And this is something we do to help conserve the bee and other insects. I have a proud title. I was given the award of the Bee Friendly Farmer of the Year by Pan UK in 2012. To the horror, I then turned into the bloke that was applying for a neonic derogation 3 years later. But hey, that's politics. I'm proud of the work we do on our farm. And we manage the hedges in a way. We don't cut them every year, which means that it's good for blossom, which again is good for insects. I just generally try where I can on the edge of the field to manage my farm with wildlife in mind. But in the middle of the field, I go all out for hardcore yield. That's my business. So while I will get a small payment for the margin based on income foregone, what keeps my bank manager happy is the crops in the middle of the field where I grow my milling wheat or my oilseed grape. And I will go throughout and out yield. I do not drown it in chemicals. That's nonsense. But where I need to use chemical control, I will do to achieve better quality and better yield. And there I am on the outskirts of Clacton-on-Sea, where we farm in an urban landscape. And I put these seed-rich plants up against my neighbour's boundaries. I'm not a great follower of Georgina Downs' idea that farmers mustn't farm anywhere near gardens, but I do understand how spraying agrochemicals can cause concern with my urban neighbours, and so I like to have a barrier of no crop next to their gardens, although I can assure you what happens if you don't manage the land is they bring the picnic tables out to you because they didn't think you wanted it, and so you have to proactively manage it, and I put these seed-rich quinoa, fenugreek and the like, sunflowers, and that area is full of small birds, finches in particular, my neighbours tell me how great it is that there are so many birds that eat in their garden, so that's a win-win situation for me. And I think I'm a great believer in farmers scientifically monitoring the biodiversity of their farms, rather than, should I controversially say, be reliant on wildlife NGOs who clearly have a political motive to identify losses before they will identify increases. Rather than relying on those organisations, I'm a great believer in farmers doing this for themselves. So here I am with my neighbour, Mr. David Wilkie. I sometimes give talks to wildlife groups, and I always joke hilariously at this point, and here I am harvesting barn owl chicks, aren't they delicious? That is a politically incorrect thing to say. What we're doing, David is a licensed ringer. You can't just go and help yourself to buy an owl chicks, so you have to be licensed. And we license the chicks so I can measure my barn owl yields. So just as a farmer, I would measure my yields of wheat. I also like to measure my yields of certain, what I call indicator species, and the barn owl is such, because as you know, the barn owl is a top predator. So if your barn owl populations are healthy, you can be pretty sure your vole populations are healthy, and you can be pretty sure that whatever the vole is feeding on is in good order. So they are good indicator species, and as I say, we've had good results from barn owl conservation on my farm, and it's one way I check how good my farm is. And I'm just on the edge of my field there, and you can see my neighbour's dairy cows in the distance. And I do get a bit tired of this sort of thing in the press. I think it's alarmist, and it's not true. It's an idea that in some way agriculture degrades the British countryside, renders it some way more sterile, as the biodiversity of a car park doesn't make it look as pretty. I think this is nostalgia. It sort of harks back to an age which didn't actually exist. I do accept that farmers do have an impact on the look and the biodiversity of the countryside, and there were big changes in the 50s and 60s and 70s as agriculture intensified, although there wasn't huge complaint about it then. But since that time, we've pulled back slightly. We haven't recreated the landscape of 1935, and why should we? Who's to say 1935 was the year when God was in his heaven and all was right with the world? But we have added margins, and to say that we have killed everything in the countryside is alarmist and not very scientific, but it sells newspapers. I'm a great believer in getting the message out there. The farmers must be more proactive with their communication to explain about the management of their farms, to explain how they manage their farms for the benefit of bees and birds, and that's the sort of sign we have on our farm. And I'll leave you with an image of the Timbering Show, which is my local show, where we treat it as a shop window to explain what farmers do. I'm a great believer, as I said, in farmers must be more proactive with the communication. There is an increasing disconnect between the agriculture community and the non-farming community. We were the first country in the world to urbanise and industrialise. We have, whereas the French are only two or three generations away from being an agrarian society, we are four or five. And so farmers need to take this issue seriously. And whether we like it or not, agriculture, because it has an impact on food quality, on the look of the environment, the biodiversity of the environment, and the fact we keep animals, will always excite controversy. Neonicotinoids are yet another issue that farmers will have to roll up their sleeves and realise that they've got to play politics, but they've also got to play the communication game. On that note, I shall stop pontificating, and I'm more than happy to have questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, that was really fascinating. On a more technical matter, what evidence would you need to have to show whether neonicotinoids are really affecting bee populations significantly, and how could that evidence be gathered?
That's a very good question and a pertinent one. We feel that there hasn't been enough research done, but there are some trials being undertaken at the moment which are more comprehensive and more wide-ranging than has been done in the past. It's been done by the Institute of Terrestrial Ecology. We are hoping to hear those results fairly soon. And look, you know, I am not in some way ideologically committed to using neonicotinoids, just as my father wasn't ideologically committed to using DDT. When the evidence emerged of environmental problems, we accepted the time was to stop. If scientific evidence emerges to show there is a significant impact on bee health, then we will have to accept it's not acceptable to use those materials anymore, and the ban is legitimate, and we will react accordingly. Now, you might say, well, haven't the European Union banned it, so why are you still bleating on? Our concern is that we felt that the European ban was done on a rather populist platform. And one thing that worries us is that the way pesticides are regulated in Europe and the rest of the world is diverging quite significantly, and farmers in Britain are being placed at a competitive disadvantage by having greater levels of environmental regulation that our competitors do not have. And the backdrop of this, of course, is a globalised world where farmers are no longer protected from competition from elsewhere and are expected to compete. And our complaint would be we cannot compete on an unlevel playing field where you have different regulatory regimes overseeing what farmers can and can't do on their farm. Sorry, that's rather but I hope that partly answered your question.
Would it be possible in present conditions to just try different weeds which would complement the, say, the rapeseed, and these would prevent certain pests from coming and annoying the plants?
The problem with that is it restricts the herbicides you can use, because if you had, say, beans and wheat in the same field, the herbicide you use for beans might kill the wheat and vice versa. So it's probably, it's not impossible. And there was the traditional Essex way was to grow peas and oats in the same field, and there was a synergistic benefit because the peas used to climb the oat straw. But the yield, even with the oats and the peas, was not very good. And of course, what you did with that pea and oat mix is you fed it to horses because they were your power source before the Second World War, and of course, tractors drink diesel, not peas and oats. So I am interested in intercropping. And look, you know, farmers should never be frightened of new ideas, and they should never think they must carry on farming the way they did yesterday. That's ridiculous. And if someone can show me a new technique whereby I can control insects or diseases in a novel way, a way I haven't done in the past, I'm there interested to have a look at it. What I'm wary of is being sort of fed some sort of a new regime that hasn't really been thought through and is problematic and is less profitable, because at the end of the day, if I don't make a profit, I go broke. But in France in particular, they're looking at growing wheat in amongst trees. And it's interesting, but it's difficult in practicality, and I don't think it's proven that the wheat benefits from the trees. But it's worth looking at. But in terms of achieving biodiversity, the policy on my farm is to, I would say, to use intensive conservation on the 5% margin of my farm next to my watercourses, and intensively farm for production 95% of the field. And that's where I think you can achieve a good balance of achieving biodiversity and efficient crop production.
Presumably, neonicotinoids are used worldwide. Are these associations with things like the colony collapse found in all areas where the insecticides are used, or is this patchy?
Neonicotinoids are only banned in the European Union. They are used in every other agriculture. The Canadians are possibly thinking about banning it, as are the Californians. The Californians ban lots of things, not usually on the grounds of science. I digress. The only place in the world where they have not seen significant colony collapse is Australia. In Australia, they use neonicotinoids, but they do not have varroa mite. The Australians have very strict phytosanitary controls of their borders. As a farmer, I like going to Australia because I get my shoes cleaned, courtesy of customs, every time I go through. Australian farmers can waltz into Heathrow and no one even asks them whether they're farmers. There is a different approach. And you could argue that the Australians have kept varroa mite out of Australia and they've stopped the bee and hive collapse syndrome that they've seen elsewhere in the world.
So there are many ways an isolated nation.
Yes, it helps being on the other side of the world, surrounded mainly by ocean, granted, rather than being a small group of islands on the edge of the most densely populated part of the world, otherwise known as Europe.
Are bees the only insect that people are concerned about, or are there others that might be affected?
Well, I mean, bees are the poster creature shall we say, that the media have recently responded to, and you know, children, bees, very emotive, a good seller for bug life, and so on. But of course, you know, all insects are an important part of the food chain. So if I want to encourage insectivore birds on my farm, they're not eating bees, they're eating a variety, a plethora of other insects, and so they're important to the ecology of my farm just as well.
Obviously, good practice is incredibly important, and I think you've demonstrated that you're very aware of these issues and therefore demonstrating very good practice, and you were probably doing good practice across the board before even the neonics issue came up. But obviously not everyone is like that. So, you know, if everyone was doing practice as good as you, maybe we wouldn't have a problem. So I suppose the lecture is, are farmers be aware? You are, but are farmers? And if they're not, is that why we either need better regulation or maybe even something more over the top because we can't trust them?
Yeah, and a good point. And, you know, just as there are probably different calibre of chemists, there are different calibre of farmers, and every farm is different, and every farmer is different, and the way they manage their farm will never be the same. However, I would argue that I manage my farm very differently to the way my father did, and I am typical of a trend amongst farmers. Now, it's difficult to... Well, it's easy to generalise. It's difficult to ground down his fingers to prove the point. But, you know, if you remember I said that 75% of farmers are in these conservation schemes, which is indicative of the fact that farmers accept environmental responsibility in a way that maybe the previous generation would not have. And I honestly believe that what I do is more the norm than the exception, although I would confess that I'm probably more committed and more interested in this than some of my neighbours. So there is an element of truth in what you say, but I think generally I recognise it across agriculture. I'm not unique or exceptional in the way I go about this conservation-friendly management.
You mentioned that that's at the beginning about the main pest is the beetle. Has a search been made for biological control of that? Given that it's a single pest is the main problem of this particular crop. And secondly, shall I go straight on to the second one?
Sure.
You mentioned that it's sometimes necessary to spray with a different insecticide during the flowering.
Yes.
And that the switch in interest had gone from hive bees to bumblebees.
Yes.
It's in two halves, actually. I'm curious to know why it's necessary to spray the flowering stage for this particular crop, okay? And it's significant, it's particular, I think, because the flying length of day for bumblebees is much longer, or can be much longer, than for hive bees. Okay. So I understand it.
Yeah. Okay. The natural predation of cabbage stem flea beetle, I think carabid beetles will eat them and some birds will, but they come in swarms. Predators are not capable of impacting on them. It may be that, you know, your grass margins may harbour some predatory insects, and that will help. But on the whole, I've never seen an obviously red field in the middle of a wood or a grass area and found that there's so many natural predators that flea beetle isn't an issue. It usually is. But it's partly caused by farmers growing lots of oilseed rape. So I readily admit that if we extended our rotations to 1 year in 10, we would probably get less pressure. But then I'm afraid economics come into play. And rape is an important break crop for a farmer growing wheat. So, you know, farmers will good rotation will limit pests to a certain extent, but you cannot extend the rotation so widely that economics do not become more important. Bumblebees, I didn't know that, that they have a longer flying period. But again, and this might sound a bit brutal, but I'm in the business of spraying at night. I like to go home and sleep, so I will spray late in the evening, but come 10 o'clock, I need my bed. And I wouldn't expect my staff to be working through the night. I don't think that's fair on them. Life's sometimes about compromises, and that is one of them.
And now they have some pest thresholds developed for flea beetles and also pollen beetles.
Yeah.
I wonder if it's useful for oyster farmers. Are there many farmers use this, or is that in order to reduce some pesticide use? Or
The way it's done with those beetles is that the indicator is the amount of damage to the plant. So a farmer will go out with his agronomist and assess the amount of damage in the crop and then assess whether it needs to be sprayed again. Now, but, obviously you make a good point because, as I said before, before the farmer decides to use neonicotinoid, it's very difficult for him to assess whether it's actually necessary, because you need a crystal ball, basically. And I don't know of any traps to monitor flea beetle and pollen beetle, but I do know that, as a practical farmer, that when the oilseed rape crop arrives in my store, when we combine it in July, I will look at the heap and see how many pollen and flea beetle there are on there, and I then will get a clear image in my own mind what the pressure is like out there. But maybe I should look at that. I do use pheromone traps for other insect pests, which I will use to inform my decision of whether I'm going to use an insecticide. But I don't do it for rubber-stem flea beetle and pollen beetle.
There are lots of things that people have suggested. I think if you're going to control cabbage-stem flea beetle in germinating or seed rape, one way to do it might be with an ovicide rather than with a larvicide or another adulticide. Catch them before they hatch.
Mm-hmm.
Now, of course, that's going to be much harder to do, although there are compounds that might do that. People talked about biological control, you talked about predatory insects. There are also entomophagous fungi. They will grow on insects and destroy them. The trouble is, of course, there have to be a lot of insects there, and they grow quite slowly, which might not be what you want.
Yeah.
The other thing I was going to mention the Australian thing, so I'm really glad that you did. But the question that I sometimes asked and no one's answered is, I think in Italy they banned the neonicotinoids a year before everybody else. It wasn't Italy, it was France. So they've had 3 years of no seed treatments, no use in flowering crops.
Mm.
Has the bee population increased in those countries? If I wanted to ban the compounds, I would do the study and make sure that the bees had increased. But I haven't heard anything, which must make me think they haven't increased. But it takes us back to bad weather and feral mites.
Yes.
My experience of weather in this country is quite often in the early spring, we get hot, dry, sunny weather. All the wildflowers flower, all the bees come out. Then for 3 weeks it gets cold and wet, and the bees go back home, they don't come out, and they starve. Is that a possibility?
Well, to take your first question first, sort of better targeting with selective insecticides, that's, we've been there in other crops, and if chemical manufacturers of the world, God bless them, can develop materials which are affordable, or, well, that's, this is the trouble. and effective, and when I say affordable, I don't mean cheap, I mean that they are cost effective, then any farmer will look at them, and we would expect the regulator to say, you've now got a alternative, and we're taking the original away, and that's fair, as long as it's there and it keeps us competitive. Sorry, and the second question was about... this is one of our gripes, is that this work hasn't been done, and it should be. When we sort of asked the Commission what was the evidence base for banning neonicotinoids, we thought it was very flimsy. And it was done on correlation and extrapolation, and we felt that a need to do some in-field, good old-fashioned scientific number crunching. And we hope that this is now being done. But it's a good point, and it is one of our gripes.
Somebody told me that a lot of organisations, particularly universities, some less credible universities, put in grant applications to do experiments that show that these insecticides do harm bees because they know they'll get money to do it. And then, of course, they have to produce a positive result from a bad experiment. How do you control that?
Well, that's one for the scientific community and not for me as a farmer. But I have heard that suggested. And it's interesting, it's interesting at Sussex University, there are two leading entomologists on bees. One is Dave Golson, who has been a leading researcher on this issue and lectures internationally on it, and is one of the people that the regulators listed. And then there's Norman Carrick. Norman Carrick is an advisor to the BBKA, and Norman is far more relaxed about the use of neonicotinoids and its impact on bees. And when I met Norman, I said, Norman, why do we never hear from you, but we only hear from Dave? Norman said, well, Dave's a campaigner, I'm a scientist. I'll leave that one in here. Dave Golson would probably hit you with a lightning bolt if he heard this, but there you are.
It was just to say that the situation might not be quite so easy to... There are too many factors involved. I'm talking about the Italian problem with where they've stopped the neonicotinoids. But in the meantime, there are other problems that have come to the fore, such as pests, the small hive beetle and the Asian hornet, which muddies the water. So it's not a study you could easily make.
The environment is, it has an almost infinite number of variables, including the weather, and all these things will impact on the ecology of the environment, and frequently in environmental or ecological science, you have to select one particular area of study to distill it down so it has some scientific, it is possible to do it, I suppose is the word I'm searching for, and there may be another area that hasn't been looked at. And I suppose as farmers, we would say, look, come on, let's try and understand it across the piece. But, that's sometimes easier said than done, but it's a very valid point.